Let us pray. Lord, thank you that the kingdom of light prevails. Thank you that your kingdom is the kingdom that you've called us into, God. Thank you, God, for our salvation. Thank you for your leadership in our lives. Thank you, Lord, that we don't have to worry, but we can worship. Thank you, God, that we can cast every care upon you because you care for us. We pray now for this part of our service, Lord. We thank you in advance for what you will do in the hearts of your people today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, it's been a tough couple of weeks, hasn't it? Financially, Wall Street. I tell you, I know way more about Wall Street than I ever wanted to know now. I don't think I understand anymore, but I know more. It's been a tough couple of weeks. We've got the market going up and down. We've got all kinds of resolutions that people think should happen right in the middle of the presidential election. We've got all these things happening. We have the bailout plan that's just now been voted on. We have all of our feelings about how that's going to affect us. And then we have our lives, the personal part of all of that, and how it affects us, our 401ks, our savings accounts, our own stocks on the stock market, if we have any. Do we have to go to the bank and get money out because we're afraid that because of FDIC, if the bank closes, we aren't going to be able to have all that money that we have in there? We've got banks being taken over by the government. We've got banks being taken over by other banks. It's like the big fish swallowing the little fish because the little fish can't afford to live. And all this affects us. We see it, we watch it, we hear it. Everywhere we go, people are talking about it. It's like when there's a hurricane coming. That's the most stressful part for me is when a hurricane is coming, is everywhere I go, from getting my hair cut to Walmart, people are talking about the hurricane. Can we just stop talking about the hurricane? That's the way I feel right now about the financial mess. Yes, I'm aware of it. Yes, I know what's going on, but can we talk about something else? Isn't it a beautiful day outside? Thank God it rained. We really needed it. But that's where we are right now. It's a crisis. It's historic. This country has never seen what we are experiencing now. You and I are living in historic times. Even the Great Depression that happened wasn't like this. People are saying we're headed for a depression. We're headed for a recession. We're headed for major debt. We're in major debt. People are doom and gloom and doom and gloom. All these things that are happening. And today the name of the sermon is Wall Street or Worship. But I'm not going to tell you about Wall Street because really Wall Street for us right now equals worry. Equals worry. And there's a lot of worry going on in this world, isn't there? There's a lot of worry going on. The Bible says to us, we heard it in our scripture today, do not store up treasure on earth. Now, I just want to clarify something. Does that mean that we aren't supposed to have savings plans? No. Does that mean we aren't supposed to have 401ks and take care of ourselves for our future? No. What that does mean, though, is that don't store up treasure on earth and hoard it and save it and be greedy. What it means is if you do store up treasure on earth and you're able to store up treasure on earth, give. Be generous with that giving. Be generous with that money that God has given to you. Be generous. And if you have ever seen the movie Ice Age, there's this little character named Scrat. And at the beginning of the movie, Scrat has saved about 5 million acorns because he knows the Ice Age is coming. And for those of you that had kids, you're nodding your heads at me. So he gets that final acorn. And he takes the acorn and he gets up to the top of this hollow tree. And he gets to the top of this hollow tree and he has like acres of acorns. He sees all of his acorns there, and he's got this one final acorn, and they're all spun in there. It doesn't look like any one more acorn can fit, but he's got this one acorn, and so he takes it over. It's just what he sounds like, and he puts it down, and boom, puts it in there, gets it in, turns around, takes a couple steps, boom, the acorn pops out. He does that about 3 or 4 times. Can't get that last acorn to fit. He's got millions of acorns, but he knows that he can get that one more acorn in there. Well, the way it turns out is he finally gets the acorn in there, but it loosens all the acorns at the bottom of the tree. And shortly thereafter, from this tree sitting on top of this huge cliff, 5 million acorns come flying out the hole in the bottom of the tree, including Scrat, into the middle of the air. Meanwhile, he's got all these acorns falling. He's falling. It's kind of like a Roadrunner show. You can see the ground coming, 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 coming. And he's gathering acorns in the air. You know, he's falling to the ground. He's gathering all these acorns in the air. He's got them all gathered. Ends up on the ground with no acorns. Moral of the story, he was saving them all for himself. God says, store up your treasure in heaven. Store up your treasure in heaven where moth and rust cannot destroy. Moth and rust cannot destroy. So is it okay to save? Of course it's okay to save. But if you're saving to the point where right now, with everything that's happening, you're worried about those savings, what does that say about our relationship with our savings? What does it say about it? I've even seen situations that my own family has been in, especially from just being back there with them, and how they react. We have never gone through what we are seeing now. But as Christians, we have to be careful about how we handle this situation, don't we? We have to be careful about worrying. Because when we're worrying, where is our mind? Squarely on ourselves, isn't it? Our mind is not on the Lord. Our mind is on ourselves. When we worry, we say, number one, I'm assuming total control. Control, remember that word, over this detail of my life. By worrying about item X, whatever it is, your finances, your job, whatever's going on, we're saying, we are, indirectly, and Ray, correct me if I'm wrong, we're saying that this item is under our control because we're worrying about it. So we have to do something about it. The funny thing is that most of the stuff that we worry about is totally out of our control. We have no control over it. We assume, though, that there's something we can do about it. Most of the time, we're not sure what it is we can do about it. But we assume there's something we can do about it. And really, to solve the problem, we just have to figure out what that something is. Making any sense? No. Neither does worry. Someone very close to me says all the time, oh, well, we'll worry about that later. Well, I'm not going to worry about it at all. And what they're saying was, well, that's a detail that we can worry about later. No. We don't have to worry about things. It's as if taking care of a detail is going to cause us worry. Why is it so easy for us to worry? Are we hardwired to worry? Are we born with worry? No. We're taught it, aren't we? We're taught worry. And some of us were taught worry really, really well. Really well. So I'm assuming control over this. Why does that freak us out to hear that? Because we're control freaks. Admit it. Come on. Come on. Don't look at me like that. We're control freaks. Type A, control freak, know every detail, have to take care of it. Everybody's squirming now. Talking about myself, too. No. No, we're not control freaks. We think that it's as if it's under our control, then we'll be able to do something more about it, thereby getting it over with quicker, and then we don't have to worry about it anymore, right? It's done. It's done. Well, what do we worry about? When it comes to worry, studies have shown the following statistics. Okay, now stay with me here. 40% of what we worry about never happens. Well, that's almost half. We can scratch that off our list. So in essence, we're wasting our time by worrying. Still with me? 30% of what we worry about has already happened. So that's 70% already. way past half. Learn to let go and forgive yourself and others. We can't change the past. Nobody can. We're worried about water that's already under the bridge. Accept it for what it is and move on. 12% are needless worries, such as what someone else thinks about us. Who cares about that? All of us. Yeah? Come on, let's be honest, guys. 10% are petty and unimportant, such as we worry about what's for dinner. I worry about that way too much. We worry about being late. We worry about what to wear, brown socks or blue. 8% of us worry about what actually happens, but of this 8%, 4% of our worries that happen are beyond our control. We can't change the outcome. These worries may include a hurricane. If it's coming, it's coming. Put your shutters down and go to a shelter. Oftentimes, the reality of these events are more bearable than the worry. So it turns out that we worry, and then the event goes by, and it's not that bad. It's not that bad. And then the other 4% of that 8% of things that actually happen, the other 4% of what we worry about, we have some, if not all, control over the results. That's not a whole lot, is it? Not a whole lot of control. So when we worry, we are saying, again, to review, that we are taking control over this situation. Does that sound biblical to anybody here? No. Number two, we are also saying that God is not able to take care of me in this situation, right? The Bible says, cast all your cares upon the Lord, for he cares for you, except for this situation. Okay, I've got this one, God, so you're not able to take care of this for me, so we've systematically taken God out of the equation. Okay, Father, I've got this one. You've got enough to handle today. I know you're busy, and you must be tired. You never sleep. So I'll take this one today. You go and do something else for somebody else, because I know that you've got a lot to handle. So I'll take this one for me today, because I'm in control. I'll let you know what I need when I need it. Thanks. You can go for now. When we take control over a situation in life without prayer, without listening to him, without trusting in his leading, without waiting, without following, we are putting ourselves in a very precarious position. In a sense, we are saying for that moment in time that he is not Lord over our lives. Ooh. You are not God in my life in this situation. We're putting him in the passenger seat instead of the driver's seat. Thought I was in England there for a minute. We're making him the co-pilot instead of the pilot. You ever see that sticker? God is my co-pilot. If God is your co-pilot, you better get in another airplane. We're giving him part-time status in our lives. Part-time status. So we worry. And we worry, and we worry. There was a woman named Lisa Owens who worked in a veterinarian's office, and she was facing knee surgery. She was a bit nervous about it, so she asked her boss, the vet at the clinic where she worked, if he had any advice for her. And her boss, the vet, was very comforting, and without any hesitation, he told her, turn your worries into prayers. Get plenty of rest before the surgery, and don't lick your incision. Number three. Review, number one and number two. We're taking control. We're saying God can't handle it. Number three, when we worry, we are putting our bodies through huge amount of stress. Huge amounts of stress. What does constant worry cause? Cause pain, and it causes disease. Because of the high levels of anxiety and our inability to let it go, our body takes a beating. It's worse than any workout that you could ever do for yourself, for your body. Ask any doctor, Ask any psychiatrist. Ask any psychologist. Headaches, muscle aches, ulcers, intestinal disorders, and perhaps some even more serious diseases. I know there's lots of research out there that looks at this kind of stuff. Not to mention insomnia, depression, severe anger, self-loathing. That's a terrible path to go down if you keep worrying. Proverbs 12:25 says, anxiety in the heart of man causes depression, but a good word makes it glad. Amen? You know, when you worry, I've noticed when I'm starting to worry about something, if I just simply smile, if I just choose to smile, it makes a difference. When I start to, then what am I going to do? What am I going to, don't have enough gas. I don't have enough. If I just smile and take that stress off my mind, it takes more effort for me to smile. So now I'm thinking about smiling. Well, what am I smiling about? Oh, now I'm thinking about things to smile about. Worry has the potential to cause serious complications in our body. And again, I'm going to say it again. We've been listening to it for 8-9 years, and gosh, I hope we listen to it for the rest of our lives here. The way you think affects the way you feel, which affects the way you act. I taught that in a Wednesday night service one night. Ray told me I could make hundreds of dollars telling people that every day. The way you think affects the way you feel, which affects the way you act. Nobody can consistently act in a way that is inconsistent with the way they feel and think. Even if you think you're acting cool, I'm good, everything's good. No, I'm all right. Come on, we know, we can tell. People know when I'm not thinking and feeling well. They ask me all the time, you okay? Because you're freaking out right now. Can you relate? Can you relate? So why do we continue to worry? Listen to this statistic. This is cool. According to the National, yes, I just came back from California. It's cool. According to the National Bureau of Standards, a dense fog covering 7 city blocks to a depth of 100 feet is composed of something less than 1 glass of water. So go downtown to Fort Lauderdale. Go from 1st to 7th and from Andrews to 7th. And go up 10 floors. That's 100 feet, right? And that much fog, 7 blocks, 100 feet of fog, fits in 1 glass of water. If you could collect all that water, I know. I couldn't believe it either. In fact, I was sharing it with somebody last night, and I had to go and find it again somewhere else so that I could verify it. 1 glass of water. When we take all the time that we spend on our worries and condense them down to what they really amount to, 1 glass of water. Does that bring it all home? We worry way too much. Way too much. If we could see into the future, and if we could see our problems in their true light, they wouldn't blind us to the world, to living itself. But instead, those problems, just like the water and the fog, could be relegated to their true size. So how do we stop worrying? Worship. Worship is the answer. When we worship, we surrender. We give God control. We admit we really have no control, which we really don't. We give our lives, our whole lives, over to the Lord for His leading on His path, for His guiding light, for His solutions to the problems in His way and in His, here's the key, time. Oh, we don't like that. Makes us worry more. I want it done now because I don't want to have to worry about it anymore. Don't worry about it. But if you take care of it now, I wouldn't have to worry about it. Stop worrying about it, Leslie. But God, why don't you, my time. Right. Your time. Right. We worship. The problem is, and I'll say it again, we want to be in control. Anybody else want to add themselves to the control freak category that we had earlier? Still just a few hands going up. That's okay. That's okay. We want to be a person of action. Especially anxiety creates all this what? Adrenaline. And adrenaline is what? Fight or flight, right? We got to do something with that. We got to move around. We got to do something. Well, if you feel that way when you're going through anxiety, go to the gym. Go for a walk. Go mow the lawn. If you don't have a lawn, mow somebody else's lawn. Make sure you tell them first, though. Make sure it's okay with them. Look at it this way. You're in the ocean. This occurred to me last night. You're in the ocean. You have no boat. Stop looking at me. You have no boat. You have no life preserver. You have no surfboard. You have no external flotation device whatsoever. And you're in the ocean. You can't swim. You have one of two choices. One of two choices. You can worry and panic, and you can begin to thrash. And you're going to make a lot of noise, and you're going to use up a lot of energy, and pretty soon, you're going to go under. Or you can float. And you don't need to know how to swim to float. Some of us float a lot better than others. You can lay back on your back, put your arms out, and breathe. Slowly, gently, calmly, and float. You will not go under. And you can float like that, I don't know how long, indefinitely. Long, long time. So do we worry? Or do we worship? Do we put our hands out and surrender? And we say, it's yours. It is yours. It's not mine. I want to float in your grace. I want to float in your mercy. I want to float in your love. I want to float. Worry is our enemy. Worry takes our eyes off of God and puts our eyes back on us or the situation. And we take our eyes off God and we give anything else more attention than we give God, it becomes an idol. And if we have things in our lives that we're worrying about that has become an idol, think about it. Think about it. Instead of worrying about your situation, worship. Instead of worrying about something that's going on, speak his word back to him, such as Psalm 94:19. In the multitude of my anxieties within me, your comforts delight my soul. Your comforts delight my soul. Philippians 4, 6-9 instructs us in the following way. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. That's worship. In prayer and supplication, in everything, with thanksgiving, hand it over to the Lord and worship him by saying, it's yours, not mine. Worship him in all his splendor. Give him control back. If there's a situation in your life where you've taken control back from God, give it back to him. Give it back to him. And I want to take it one step further this week. And I'm going to put a challenge out to you. Okay? And if you want to write this down, write it on your bulletin. I want to challenge us for 30 days to to write our cares down. You can write them down at night, or you can write them down in the morning whenever you do your prayer time, or you can write them down as they're happening, as they occur to you. Write them down. And every day when you have your quiet time, whether it be 5 minutes or 50 minutes, I don't care. I don't want to know how long your quiet time is. But I want you to take those worries that you've written down. And I would like for you, if you feel led, to put them before you, keep them in your Bible, put them before you, and pray over them. And tell God each one, Lord, I give you my finances. I give you my job. I give you this situation with this person. I give you this problem that I've had. I give you my boss. Not you. I didn't mean to look at you when I said that. Just back from vacation and, oh God, I need a job. Write them down and pray over them and give them to the Lord. And give them to the Lord. Give them to the Lord. And then one other thing I'd like you to do. Just email in to me that you're joining me on this 30-day challenge. Because I'm going to do it starting tomorrow. Okay? And I'll send an email reminder out too. That you're going to join me on this challenge. And if you just want to write and say, I'm joining you or whatever. And if you don't want to let me know, and if you just want it to be between you and God, that's great. But for 30 days, let's all do that together. And you know what? There's power in prayer. There is power in prayer. And there is power in this place because the Lord is here. His power is here to make changes in your lives. Is it scary? Only for a moment until we remember that He's got our back. God's got our back. Listen to this memo from God as I close. Memo to do today from God to Christian. Today, I will be handling all of your problems. Please remember that I do not need your help. If the devil happens to deliver a situation that you cannot handle, do not attempt to resolve it. Kindly put it in the SFJTD, something for Jesus to do box. It will be addressed in my time, not yours. Once the matter is placed in the box, do not hold on to it or remove it. Holding on to removal will delay the resolution of your problem. If it is a situation that you think you are capable of handling, please consult me in prayer to be sure that it is the proper resolution. Because I do not sleep, nor do I slumber, there is no need for you to lose any sleep. Rest, my child. If you need to contact me, I'm only a prayer away. Signed, God. That is the ultimate bailout plan. That's the ultimate bailout plan. Instead of the nearest savings and loan, enter the nearest Savior and Lord branch. Open an account with the senior banker. Let him make a deposit into your account and trust him with all you have. That's the only bailout plan you'll ever need. Amen.